As the Eurozone continues to be threatened by the unfolding sovereign debt crisis, European leaders prepare for a key EU summit this week in Brussels. But with little hope for a solution to this crisis, many are now wondering how it began in the first place. This is the GRTV Feature Interview with your host, James Corbett, and our guest, F. William Engdahl. Perhaps we can get your take on the background to this collapse and the geopolitics behind it.
Well, I think the best way to look at what's going on in the Eurozone is to look at what was going on at the end of 2009 with the dollar and with Wall Street banks. And I'm talking about the big six, roughly. Bank of America, Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan Chase, Citigroup, and so. And at that point, the Chinese were openly saying that they're about ready to consider alternatives to their dollar investments, their treasury investments, which were by then well over close to $2 trillion, as I recall. And that's serious money, because the Chinese felt that the U.S. fiscal policy was profligate, which it certainly was. And at that point, suddenly, mirabilis dictu, or deus ex machina, whatever you want to call it, a crisis erupted under the new Papandreou, newly elected Papandreou government in Greece, where they announced that the actual size of the Greek public debt was vastly larger than the previous conservatives had announced to the public. And that what came out is that in 2002, the conservative government in Greece was able to sneak into the Eurozone and meet the strict criteria on the surface, strict criteria of debt to GDP and other criteria, by hiding the real debts that they were incurring through exotic derivatives that were crafted for them by none other than Goldman Sachs. Interesting. Okay, we'll keep that name in mind because in a few minutes it's going to make more sense. Well, 2002, Goldman Sachs is on the inside of the game. Papademos, the so-called technocrat who's now running the Greek government under this national emergency coalition, Papademos was head of the Greek National Bank in 2002, facilitating as a counterparty this semi-legal, it was legal technically, but in fact it was illegal in the spirit of the Maastricht Treaty, this hiding of the Greek debt. So Papademos was in on the fix from the beginning. He didn't say, Goldman Sachs, I think this is a dishonest deal that you're doing in spirit, and we shouldn't do this. We should be honest that we're not ready to enter the Eurozone. No, he didn't do that. His assistant at the Central Bank of Greece at the time had come from Goldman Sachs. Another interesting fact. We just leave these as facts. Okay, then Greece comes in, the weak link of the euro. Greece comes into the Eurozone. And in December 2009, lo and behold, it comes out that Greece is not qualified to be in the Eurozone because of this huge debt that it's carrying. So suddenly, the attention of financial speculators, hedge funds and others, but it's, of course, the Wall Street banks, goes on to one theme, the weakness of the euro construct. Now, this has been a sleeping dog since the euro came into being in 1999, 2000, 2001. That there is no central fiscal policy, but there is a central bank. And so long as there wasn't a massive speculative attack on the euro and on the bonds of the eurozone countries, that wasn't a problem. And it was papered over. Everybody knew about it in Brussels. Everybody knew about it in Germany and Greece and all these other countries. But they hoped that the test would somehow not come. Well, the test did come, and it's come big time. Then in early 2010, we had a situation where there was a meeting in New York, and this was reported, I believe, in the New York Times, as I recall. There was a meeting of several of the largest hedge fund operators or managers in the world. Among them, our friend George Soros of Quantum Fund, or Soros Management Group, it's called. And they discussed the quote-unquote Greek problem. And you can bet that those hedge funds discussing in common, they weren't just having a casual cup of coffee talking about the latest World Series game. They were talking about where to put their money on which side of the speculative ledger. And so of course, when the big boys go in on a speculative bet, then all sorts of small hedge funds and investment funds and others around the world began to take notice in banks, and they pile in behind. And that's pretty much what happened. So there was a speculative wave of attack against Greek sovereign debt. And that put the focus on the euro, took the pressure off the dollar, interestingly enough. And, so as that crisis developed into March of 2010, the day that there was a consensus reached in principle among the leaders, the political leaders of the Eurozone countries, Angela Merkel for Germany and Sarkozy in France and so, on that same day, Standard & Poor's did something unprecedented in its history. They never did this when the long-term capital management crisis was erupting. They never did it during the dot-com bubble or the Exxon crisis when the warning signals were there flashing red well beforehand. They not only downgraded the sovereign debt of Greece, they downgraded it three notches. Now, three notches happened to put the debt of Greece into so-called junk bond category. And that meant that pension funds all around the world who were holding supposedly secure sovereign debt, it's something that doesn't default very often. You can look it up in the record books. Suddenly, they were forced by their regulations of what pension funds can and cannot hold. They were forced to dump all the Greek debt on the same day onto the market. Well, that exploded. And of course, we can imagine that Goldman Sachs, Morgan Stanley, Bank of America, JP Morgan Chase were piggybacking on this with all sorts of credit default swaps and just leveraging the speculative pressure against the Greece sovereign debt and also the Eurozone.
Well, a very, very important analysis, and I think something that is missing from too much of the analysis out there. So allow me to perhaps draw out and spell out some of the things that you tactfully left unsaid there. But I take it that your implication is that the entire Eurozone collapse has been at least partially triggered by Anglo-American banking interests who have a vested interest in maintaining the dollar hegemony well past the death of the petrodollar paradigm. And that this is some sort of speculative attack.
I don't see any other way to understand it. And this is, it's not merely a speculative attack, but once you set the snowball rolling down the mountain, the avalanche begins to ensue. And that's what we're seeing happening after the initial snowball was thrown. And it was deliberately thrown by Wall Street, by Treasury Secretary Geithner, by Bernanke at the Fed. The comments they made during this whole sensitive time were not constructive. They were, no other interpretation is possible. They were designed to feed into the crisis atmosphere around the euro. There's one very big difference, James, that I have to add here. The difference between the underlying real economy of the Eurozone countries and that of the United States, which has now 103% debt to GDP, it's U.S. is getting in the range of the Greek debt to GDP ratios or the Italian. The U.S. doesn't have a real economy base to rebuild on. The multinational corporations, the Wall Street banks, and so forth, over the last 30 years have made a conscious political decision, geopolitical decision, to outsource American industry to Asia, Eastern Europe, Poland, in some cases to Russia, to China above all, and to simply take that as a pure financial play, and irrespective of what that's done to hollow out the industrial base of the American economy. If you go into an American, a quality American graduate school for engineering or science today, MIT, Caltech, you name it, I venture to say that a large number, if not a majority, of the graduate students going for PhDs in science and engineering in those universities in America today are going to have Chinese surnames, Asian surnames above all. It may be Indian, it doesn't matter. But they are not recruiting doctors and engineers in the graduate level in American universities from inside the United States. It's largely coming from outside. So the climate of entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is fine, but what are you going to entrepreneur? What are you going to build with your brilliant brain? You can't eat IT, web network solutions. You can't eat. I recall having a discussion when I was on a recent visit in China with a professor from a very prestigious American university who had East Coast University, who had a project in China. And we were talking about the doldrums of the American economy. He was rather gentle in his critique. And I said, well, I see the biggest problem is the hollowing out of the industrial base and the real economy in the United States. It's gone into a service economy. He said, yes, that's a very serious problem, although there are bright spots. For example, there's a whole new industry growing up developing apps for iPhones. And I had to hold myself back from laughing at this distinguished professor, because let's look at what it takes to feed and clothe a nation of 360 million people at an adequate standard of living for the 21st century. You have to have more than apps to eat and put on the breakfast table. I'm sorry.
Or to engineer the iPhones on which the apps are made, which of course has also been outsourced to China. It is absolutely.
It's done in China.
Yeah.
I know.
Exactly. Well, it is. I mean, it's a self-parodying system in many ways, and it leads to me one of the interesting dichotomies here, because you mentioned, of course, the very deliberate strategy and very deliberate outsourcing of America's industrial engine to primarily China in the past few decades, but that of course necessarily builds up China as a sort of counterbalance against American hegemonic interests. So, what is the real strategy at play there?
Well, I think the real strategy at play is to pull China into the game long term. Now, the China opening was done under Nixon by Henry Kissinger, but the real doors were opened for Kissinger by his former employer, David Rockefeller. Rockefeller had the Rolodex in China, Chou Enlai, the forever foreign minister under Mao, and so forth. And by 1979, when Deng made the great opening to the West for this controlled socialist experiment, mixed socialism with capitalism, to modernize the Chinese economy, the establishment at the level of David Rockefeller, or the people who advise him, I don't know how intelligent the man is, I have my doubts, given the implications of the policies he's supported for his lifetime, but let's assume he's fairly informed, at least. Their strategy with China is to gradually, you know, there's this wonderful expression that Sybil Edmonds uses for her blog. You don't boil a frog by throwing him into a pot of boiling water. You throw him into a pot of cold water and slowly turn up the heat. Well, that, I think, is the established U.S. establishment strategy for China. They want to induce them into their game by allowing them to modernize, allowing them to produce Nike shoes, allowing them to produce GM cars or Chryslers or whatever, which they do in China in abundance, and allowing them to become, for their economic security, dependent on those Western multinationals and banks who give the credit and so forth. So they haven't done anything drastic. Often people in blogs say, well, why don't the Chinese just dump their 2.5 trillion euros or dollars worth of U.S. government bonds and show America who's boss? Well, of course, that would be devastating to the Chinese economy as well. So they're careful. They know that they're in a difficult situation of dependency, and they're slowly trying to reorient the supertanker over the last, since 2008, more toward trade links with the European Union, which is now their biggest trading partner, by the way. It's no longer Walmart, the United States. It's the European Union as a whole. So that they've done, that's one reason why this euro dollar game, this euro dollar war, if you want to call it that, has such high geopolitical stakes, because it involves the struggle over the future orientation of China as well. So the Chinese are, in my estimation, in a profound rethinking process. They're well aware that the saber rattling that's taking place in the South China Sea, for example, is directed as are a whole series of pinpricks, as I call them, in Myanmar, in other places. South Sudan, the Republic of South Sudan, is in existence today purely because the oil in South Sudan, or then Sudan, was exploited and developed by Chinese oil companies after 1999. It was brought by a Chinese-built pipeline to Port Sudan in the north, where it was loaded onto Chinese oil tankers and brought to China to fuel its economy. And southern Sudan oil fields had become, and still are, one of the largest import sources of oil for the Chinese economy. Lo and behold, Colin Powell and the United States unilaterally declare genocide is going on in Sudan against the people of Darfur. Well, they got a few Hollywood stars to be poster boys for this campaign, and suddenly everybody believes there's genocide going in South Sudan, which I've never seen documented, independent, verifiable proof that there was. But certainly there were reports of CIA arms smuggling through Chad to fuel a conflict down there to provide the excuse for bringing NATO troops and forcing the separation of South Sudan. That was directed against China as well. So a whole series of these pinpricks coinciding with a rethinking of the relationship with the U.S. have led the Chinese to realize that it's quite different world that they're being welcomed to than they thought when they were planning originally the 2008 Beijing Olympics.
Quite right, and I think you are quite astute in pointing that out. It's not something that a lot of people are pointing out, but I think more and more geopolitics really is being played out at that sort of proxy level now in what seems to be almost the type of Cold War scenario between the American interests and Chinese interests. But returning to the European aspect of this for a moment, I wonder to what extent does this Eurozone crisis really interrogate the notion that the European Union has been at any point since inception anything other than a notional idea of a union rather than an actual reality of a coherent body geopolitic on the ground in Europe itself?
Yeah, well, that's the basic flaw in the system, which the Wall Street banks have zeroed in on quite sharply. The basic flaw is there is not a United States of Europe. There is not a political union into which a monetary union was born. This was the fundamental flaw, which then Chancellor Helmut Kohl pointed out when Andreotti in Italy and the French, Mitterrand was then the president of France, at the conference in Maastricht, the infamous conference in Maastricht in the early 1990s, when Germany was unifying East and West in this deal with the four occupying powers, Russia, Soviet Union, then still Soviet Union, United States, France, and Britain. Then you had Maggie Thatcher waving her umbrella furiously against the Germans and talking about, or her press people and former ministers were talking about, the emergence of Germany as a Fourth Reich. Well, the Maastricht Treaty was imposed as a precondition from the side of the French, the Italians, and the British, although the British played low profile, a precondition for accepting a unified Germany. And that meant, from the standpoint of the French and the British, that the Bundesbank and the monetary policy of the Deutschmark had to be, I can only think of the German word, entfesselt, had to be captured, locked in to a Eurozone structure, a European structure, EU structure. And that was the European Monetary Union, where Germany's voice would be one among many, rather than the leading. Of course, during the 80s and in the previous period in the 70s and so, the Bundesbank, who was the head of the Bundesbank, you had three central bankers in the world, the head of the Bank of Japan, the head of the Fed, and the Bundesbank, and that was more or less it. The Bank of England was an echo of the Fed, largely. Well, the French and the British wanted to make sure that that Bundesbank independence was surrendered as a precondition for German unification. The Germans at first rejected that. Helmut Kohl and his advisors, at that time he was advised, I think still by Alfred Herrhausen, the assassinated head of Deutsche Bank, who had quite an interesting vision for the infrastructure development of Eastern Europe, the former communist countries, including Poland, Ukraine, Russia, and so forth, with high technology, infrastructure, rail lines, and so forth, to, of course, as the Germans did in World War One or before World War One, with the Berlin-Baghdad railway line, if you build the infrastructure, you build new markets. There's not such a, like a vacuum, nature abhors free markets. Nature abhors free markets. There are no free markets. Markets are built through economic infrastructure, and the markets follow the infrastructure. Trade follows populations and infrastructure. So that was the original design, grand design for the stabilization of Eastern Europe and the former Warsaw Pact zone, including the Soviet Union, of people around Chancellor Kohl. So the French saw that as a mortal threat to the French idea, whatever that might be. The British certainly saw that as a mortal threat. So they forced the creation of the Maastricht Treaty in the terms it was done. Well, if you look up until 1994, Helmut Kohl, who was an influential and intelligent politician, was advised by his advisors in Germany not to embrace the so-called Euro project, but to drag your feet. Well, suddenly in 1994, when the British banks were deep into the worst banking crisis since World War II over real estate speculation, ironically, the French banks were on their back. What today is BNP Paribas and Sokchan and others were in a devastated condition because they'd gone overboard in certain speculative enterprises. Well, at that point, Kohl was advised by his people, economic advisors, that if Germany were to embrace the euro, this would secure Germany's place in Europe for the next 100 years. So suddenly, Helmut Kohl came from being a foot-dragging euro skeptic to one of the most passionate embracers of the euro project one can imagine. I heard him speak shortly before he left office at a banking conference in Frankfurt, where all the top bankers in Germany were present, about his experience growing up in Germany after World War II. And these bankers had tears in their eyes. Kohl knew how to work an audience when he was convinced of something. So it was a passionate embrace by the German elites of the Euro project because they saw that it was to their advantage. And it has been to a major extent, but not in the way that it was originally seen. So a lot of water has flown under the bridge since then. But be that as it may, the fundamental flaw, which the Germans rightly pointed out at the beginning, including Schäuble, who was quite active in those talks in those days, is that there is not a political union. There's not a sovereign entity called the United States of Europe. There are 27 countries with national interests, national identities, national languages, and national economies that are by no means fully integrated. And to do that by fiat, top-down, as Valéry Giscard d'Estaing tried to do with this European constitution, is not going to work in the end of the day. The British, that's one side where I agree with British anti-Euro spokesman. You can't force something like that from top-down. It has to come from the way the French-German agreements came between de Gaulle and Adenauer in the 60s, where they said, we cannot tolerate war between our two countries anymore in this century. And that became the basis of what created the European Union, the European Economic Community, really.